Welcome, Wellesley Hills Congregational Church friends and family. Welcome to the service of celebration as the Confirmation Class of 2020 leads worship this morning. We will also share with you our stories of faith and our confirmation journeys. It was no small feat being a confirmand during a pandemic, but here we are, gathered virtually this morning with all of you, our church family. We welcome you this day. We thank you for celebrating with us. Whoever you are, wherever you are on your life's journey, you are welcome here in this virtual space. Blessing to you this day.
Today is a day of great joy and celebration as we are led in worship by members of the Confirmation Class of the Hills Church. Last fall, this group of students began a journey together, a journey to explore, to learn, and question, and grow in faith with the amazing leadership of Reverend Anne Marie Holloway and Mimi D'Angelo. I'm grateful to Anne Marie and Mimi for their wonderful leadership of this important aspect of our church's life. Confirmation is a ritual by which those who have come into the Christian community as children, who may have been baptized when they were too young to have memories of it, are able to affirm their baptism and to confirm their faith in God at an age of greater understanding and agency. Some of this year's confirmands have been members of this church for years, perhaps even for their whole lives, and others have joined us here at the Hills Church more recently, even in the last year or so. Many of them were baptized as infants and as children, and one will be baptized today. Because after today's virtual worship service, in which members of the Confirmation Class will lead us in worship, we will also hold a small in-person worship service here on the church lawn. At that service, confirmands and their families and deacons of the church will join together. Parents will perform the laying on of hands on behalf of the church, and we will offer the prayer of confirmation and the affirmation of baptism. In this virtual service, you'll get to hear reflections on faith from these confirmands. I've been remembering my own confirmation when I was 14 years old. I remember that my minister, Reverend Richard Flynn, talked about the commitment of faith as a commitment of one's life to God. And the way he described this was that at any stage of life, to commit in faith to God is to commit as much as you understand of your life to as much as you understand of God. By faith, we trust that we will continue to grow in our understandings of ourselves and in our understandings of God. So while there may be particular moments in life, like Confirmation Sunday, that are milestones in our commitment of faith, we are always growing in our commitment because we are always learning to commit as much as we understand of ourselves to as much as we understand of God. So I invite you, at whatever age or stage of life you are in, to reflect on these questions during today's worship service. How do you understand yourself? How do you understand God? What does your commitment of faith mean for you today?
Blessings to you on this wonderful Sunday. Let us enter joyfully into the sacred time together, while you join me in saying the call to worship. Jesus says we're salt of the earth, the light of the world. Brighty and bright we're God's faithful people. Let us be who we are meant to be in Christ, a welcoming oasis, a compassionate community, a justice-making people giving glory to God. Let our worship this morning reflect this light. May Christ's light shine through us all. Amen.
Grateful praise for the beauty of God's love is all-encompassing, all-forgiving, and is all around us. It is in this spirit that I invite you to share in prayer what's on your hearts before God and before one another. Let us pray the prayer of confession together. God of glory, we confess that we have not sought your face. We ignore the needs of the poor, and we turn away from our own kin. We allow the gospel to go stale and hide the light you have given. Forgive us. Give us grace. By renewing the gifts of your Spirit, inspire and empower us again. To show the wonder of your love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Be assured, people of God. When we fail, God does not. When we avoid, God seeks us out. When we forget, God calls us back. When we disengage, God builds relationships. God forgives you, God loves you, and God calls you to light, to new life, again and again. Amen.
Let us now remember the words of Jesus as is written in Scripture, calling us forth to love God and love neighbor. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no law which is greater than these. Amen.
Glory to God, the Creator, and to the Christ, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Good morning. I want to especially welcome the confirmands this morning, the confirmands and their families, to this very special service of worship. So one of the questions you may have on your mind is, why do we pass the peace? And especially in this time of COVID, when we're not really together in worship, what's so big a deal about it? What's the point? And the answer is that Christians have been passing the peace for 2,000 years, and we're not going to stop now just because COVID is in the way. Yeah, Jesus always began his greetings to his friends, the disciples, by saying, peace be with you, peace be with you, peace be with you. And St. Paul, when he was writing to the churches, always began his letters with the statement, grace to you and peace, grace to you and peace. So those are two reasons. The other reason is because when we're worshiping our God, we want to make sure our hearts are clean and open for God's love and grace. And we want to get rid of any bad feelings or sins on our hearts. So that's why we say the prayer of confession. Then we receive the forgiveness in the assurance of pardon. And then in our services, we're reminded by the summary of the law that the point of all this is to love God and then love our neighbors as ourselves. And Scripture is filled with wanting that peace to be shared amongst us, whether it's on the Sermon on the Mount, or peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, from John. So now let's open our own hearts and remember that peace starts with us and then ripples outward. May start with your family, the people in your pod, your colleagues. Then it goes on to your community, the Commonwealth, and finally our country, and then the world. But it begins with your right heart, right feeling in yourself, and then extends outward. So now, confirmands, families, people known and unknown to us worshiping together, may the peace of Christ be with you.
Peace be with you, Hills.
May the peace be with you, Hills Church.
Listen attentively to this reading of God's Word, Salt and Light. Let me tell you why you are here. You are here to be salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? You've lost your usefulness and will end up in the garbage. Here's another way to put it. You are here to be light, bringing out the God colors on this earth. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I put you here on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. This ends the reading. May God bless the reading of God's holy word.
It is in your name that we gather to pray, sing, reflect, and hear your good and holy word. Bless this time of listening. May the words spoken and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
So here we are, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, with Jesus and his disciples on the mountain. We notice here that Jesus is letting his disciples know what they are. They are salt and they are light. Jesus doesn't give the disciples instructions on how to be salt and light, or how it is that they have become salt and light. Rather, he just tells them, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." My goodness, Jesus puts the pressure on here, especially when he speaks of light. He isn't talking about small, sparkly lights or reflections of light. Rather, the disciples are the light of the world. Jesus declares this, a reference back to the very first light, the light that started all lights. In the beginning, God made light. The light God called into being in Genesis chapter 1, verse 3 is not the sun, as sometimes we commonly mistake. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, the word light is translated from the Hebrew, and it means a luminescent energy, waveform of sorts, this untouchable yet seen thing. In the beginning, God did not create or make light, but he simply said, "Be." The light shall be. Again, when translating this Hebrew into what we understand as our common translation today, "Let there be light" is what we understand it to be, but really it was a command. God just said, "Light, be." Divine command issued, one that is echoed here in Jesus' command to the disciples. You are the light. Light, remember who you are, what you are. Be the light. Jesus takes this command and transforms it into a commissioning, I think, of sorts. Be the light. Be the salt. Be the persons that you have been created to be. Persons God has called to a season that needs someone to preserve it, that needs something to preserve it, to season and preserve the world, salt of the earth, to let light shine so that others can see their good works. Yes, good works, by claiming their own identity as God's own, intended from the very beginning to be the salt and light, to be briny and bright. See, Jesus, as we have learned together, often chooses common subjects to demonstrate his teachings. And salt was so important and invaluable in ancient times, so much so that Roman soldiers were sometimes paid in salt. Salt preserved, enhanced taste, was a multi-purpose, was a useful element of the earth. And light simply cannot just go away. It is always there, even if it is put under a basket. Light cannot be hidden. Whether we want to believe that or not, we are the light, God's light of the world, born on purpose with purpose, manifested, called forth, commissioned from the very beginning. In the beginning, God said, light, be. Our confirmation class of 2020 was the first class in 20 years of walking with youth on their faith journeys that I have ever taught during a pandemic. Our heads swirled as we attempted to run ahead of what felt like a tidal wave of change, a tidal wave forcing us to adapt and all the while hold close a lot of worry. What were we to expect of and from our teens during such a stressful time? Would they even have the capacity to continue? Would not being together in physical form and sharing a meal as we love to do and praying together and laughing together and learning and sharing and being in contact with each other, holding hands while we pray, would that just change everything? And would they stop coming? Week after week, would one just fall away? Would we be able to reach one another? Would we just simply become sick of being on Zoom all the time? Would anxiety and exhaustion take over? You are the salt of the earth, the light of the world. You are salt and light, and you cannot undo that. A city on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but they put it on a lampstand, and it gives light to all of the house. And in the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. It was as if Matthew 5 was written for this very moment. Seeing the good works of our confirmands causes me to give glory to God, to Abba, the one who Jesus calls Father. Time after time, our confirmation students showed up on Zoom. All of them. All 13 of them. They let their God lights shine every week, bringing taste, preserving community, salt of the earth. They brought the best of themselves, even when they did not perhaps feel motivated to do so. They did not laugh when we attempted a Zoom candle prayer activity that would eventually set off fire alarms in my basement office. They did not scoff at conversations around what it meant to be the church, what their beliefs were around Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit. They named those who carved the paths for them, who lived godly lives and served as their light during this time. Many of them referred to their parents as those people, and of church school teachers and friends. They spoke of what they worried about. Some of the confirmands had family members who were sick. Some were had experienced the passing of a family member. Some were stressed about being cooped up in their house with their siblings during quarantine and not being able to see their friends or do sports. This group, even with the distractions of cell phones and the ability to search the internet during Zoom, we all know we do that, gave the confirmation leaders their undivided attention. Shine your light so those around you see your good works and glorify our Father in heaven. Hallelujah. Praise God for the light of these 13 young people. Following the next hymn, you will hear from our co-senior deacon and co-leader of this confirmation program here at the Hills. You will also hear the testimonies of some of our confirmation students as they share their reflections from their written faith statements. Each of our confirmands were asked to write faith statements that reflect on what the church is to them. Who is God to them? Who is Jesus? What did they believe was the Holy Spirit? What about the Bible? What was it saying? Oftentimes we would read from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible and then go to the Message version so that we could balance out the language of ancient versus today's modern translation. All of their reflections were shared among each other. We spent weeks sharing them, and we listened to one another. And together we lifted up parts that resonated with our hearts from their words. We affirmed one another. Tender, honest, sacred conversations of hope and struggle and doubt and belief, salt and light. Echoes of the psalmists. During times of great trial and tribulation, turning to one another with stories and prayer and requests and hope. May we be blessed by hearing the words of our confirmands this day. May we see the ways in which Jesus' ancient reminder of who and whose we are be brought forth. And may our confirmation students know that they are never alone on this journey, that in reaffirming the promises made by others at their baptism, they are stepping forward to be the light, to be the salt and the light. They certainly shine. They certainly have served as guides for one another, and even for the leaders of this program. We looked forward to every Wednesday evening with hope. May God's Spirit inspire their hearts and continue to guide their steps. And may we as a congregation remember the importance of continuing the journey with these young people. For they truly are the salt of the earth, the light of the world, now and forevermore. Will you join me in a spirit of prayer? O Lord, my God, maker of salt and light, giver of hope, when I in awesome wonder consider all the things that you have made, all the magnificent acts of creation your hands have made, I am humbled. Help us to recognize your awesome power when we see the stars, when we hear the rolling thunder, and when we look at each other. May we see the salt of the earth and the light of the world. And remember the command, calling us forth to be just that. O God, our souls sing out in gratitude to you this day, for those who courageously pass on your love and share your light. Oh, how great thou art. How great thou art. Amen.
Great thou art, how great thou art. It's hard to believe that we are finally at Confirmation Sunday, 4 months later than we had expected when we began 1 year ago. But since March, what has been typical or expected? Well, I'll tell you one thing. The commitment of these youth who continued with confirmation class even when classes moved to Zoom. You confirmands never missed a beat. You showed up in Zoom as you had when we met in the reception room, and you contributed to every discussion. You spoke openly about your belief in God and about how to be followers of Jesus. You embraced every opportunity Anne Marie provided. So today, you will profess your faith in God and your certainty that Jesus will walk with you and never leave your side. It has been a great privilege to be part of your journey this year, and the congregation is so fortunate to have you as members of our growing church family.
During one of the first confirmation classes, each confirmand picked up a stone from a bowl of water. Each was engraved with one word, a word that could mean anything to us. I got the word believe. This word is used in many different ways and means many different things to people. To me, saying I believe was enough. Now, I've been able to better understand the real meaning of believing. After my confirmation journey, I have a new meaning for the word believe. Believing is having faith in something you might not fully understand yet. Believing is having the ability to put trust in someone or something. Believing is the ability to know you're getting guided in the right direction. Believing in God means having the ability He's out there and He cares about you.
The people that have influenced my faith are my dad and Reverend Anne Marie. My dad was the first person to introduce me to the church. I first went to church when I was 2 years old, and my dad was the one that brought me there. He told me that he'd went to a similar church in Greensburg, Pennsylvania, when he was a child. When we walked in, I remember being mesmerized by the stained glass and the paintings on the back wall and gazing up at the organ at the front of the room. Before I knew much about Christianity, I still enjoyed being a part of the church community and the overall environment in the church. Everyone was so welcoming, and they always greeted me by name. The people of this community have always been family to me, especially Reverend Anne Marie. She has always shown me kindness and listened to me whenever I've had something to say. She has gone out of her way to help me, and I always appreciate her loving and welcoming attitude. Reverend Anne Marie has been there to guide me on my journey throughout confirmation class. Both of these important people have shown me what it means to be Christian.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from this, from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8:38-39. I found that this quote from the Bible really was the perfect way to explain the love Jesus and God have for us. The quote states that no matter what happens, no matter what, God's love for each and every one of us will be expressed through his Son, Jesus Christ.
I'm grateful for Reverend Anne Marie for guiding us through confirmation this year. We were able to maintain our own sense of community even while we couldn't leave our homes. I will never forget this experience, and I appreciate the important role that church plays in our community, especially during times of crisis.
During the last year, confirmation class has been a very important part of my life. I have learned so much about myself and about faith. I've learned more about how faith isn't just something you have at church on Sundays or on holidays. I see that faith can be about other things, like supporting people or giving back. And most of all, faith makes me feel stronger as a person and part of the community. I am so happy to be part of the Hills Church.
I believe Jesus is the Son of God, sent here to save the human race. Without Jesus, we would be lost, stumbling blindly through a faithless world. In the world before Jesus, we were lost. Once he came, we were found. He is the rescuer of all, and now that he has come and gone, we will forever be indebted to God. God sacrificed his one and only Son for the good of our kind, and if this is not the ultimate form of devotion and love, I do not know what is. God used Jesus to show his love for us. This is obvious. What is not obvious is that the only thing God wants us to do in return for this tremendous sacrifice is to love him and to love each other. The second commandment, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, is God's message to us that love for each other in the mortal realm is necessary, not optional. This is a commandment from our Creator, not a suggestion. While Jesus is the Son of God, our Savior, and our Rescuer, he is more than that. Jesus is the symbol of God's love and commitment to us.
I believe the church is the people who make up the congregation. It's the people who teach Sunday school, serve on the communities, participate in the services, lead the Easter egg hunt, and so on. They all work together to create a community and support each other by following God's will.
Jesus is the Son of God, divine, but human like us. I don't remember where and when I heard this, but it just stuck with me. Jesus, who is supposed to be perfect in every way and does not sin like us, was heartbroken when he learned that he will die on the cross and his disciples would eventually betray him. He questioned this as he prayed to God. Jesus would question God like us at times of despair. That was news to me. It made me connect to him more and feel that everyone can make mistakes, but as long as we're faithful and honest to God and ourselves, everything is okie-dokie. Just like a stuffed animal that we go to when we are in need, he knows our weaknesses and forgives us no matter how sinful we are. For me, Jesus represents the compassion and forgiveness God would hold for us.
I believe God is caring and compassionate. He listens to everyone. He's understanding of one's mishaps and is willing to forgive someone for their mistakes.
The person that influenced my faith the most is my mom. Despite games every Sunday, my mom always made sure my brothers and I got to church every possible week. And even though I hated her for dragging me along, if she didn't do so, I may not have some very important values and morals in my life today. Growing up, my mom was a member of her local church and learned valuable lessons that I've been blessed enough to receive throughout my confirmation journey. I'm very fortunate to have a mother that cares about myself and our family as much as she does. And while I still may not show my mom enough appreciation for making me go to church, if she didn't do so, I wouldn't be the person I am today. Thank you. I love you, Mom.
I believe God and the Holy Spirit are within all of us and have reasons for the things that happen in life. Whether it is good or bad, there's a greater message God is trying to display. I believe that the church is a safe spot where people can express themselves without feeling threatened or unsafe. The church is a place where young and old can learn and explore.
I think that Anne-Marie, as well as my parents, have heavily influenced my religion. Anne-Marie has guided me through Christianity and given me lessons I will carry for the rest of my life. A quote that I thought was impactful was, "God doesn't give us what we can handle. God helps us handle what we are given." This quote made me think of no matter what is going on in life, we can endure and get through it with God's help. Overall, this whole experience has been very interesting and fun, and I wouldn't change it for anything. I've learned who I am and how I interpret my faith, and have learned from my fellow classmates as well as Anne-Marie. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kara Johnson. Before we started this journey over a year ago, I was super nervous and I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know anybody, and this had been my first time really thinking and talking about my religion openly. Thankfully, I was welcomed with open arms, and everyone made me feel seen and heard in like ways that I'd never felt before. I just want to say thank you to everyone in the group, especially Anne-Marie and Mimi, for allowing me to explore my faith. I have just found this whole new perspective on religion and like who I am and what I believe, and I'm forever grateful for that. I also think that a big part of my faith is my mom. She has helped me understand and learn so much. Like, I just don't know where I would be without her. Thanks again to everyone who made this year amazing.
As we come to this time of prayerful sharing, where we share our joys and concerns, those in our lives, those on our hearts, let us lift up to God in a moment of silence all of those things that are weighing on us, all of the things we are facing in our personal lives, in our communities, in the world. Let us pray. God of grace and glory, we are grateful for the leadership of extraordinary people, those who shine light into the darkness, those who can transform a curse into a blessing. They are the gift of salt into a new harvest of hope. Make us like that, Lord, so that our faith is not in our words, but in our lives. Not in what we say, but in what we do. Passing on your love like the salt that blesses, like a city on a hill, like a lamp on a stand. Light for life. Your light for the world. We pray here this morning for all those in our community, in our families, in the world who are in need of comfort and care. Bless the poor, the sick, the weary, the wounded, the dying, the living, the newly born, the heartbroken, the lost, the searching. Those who have experienced horrible moments where violence and hatred and racism have torn families apart. Shine your light upon this mixed up, scary world. We pray that you take the brokenness and the confusion, the anxiety and the uncertainty, the injustice, and you turn it around. Help us to trust in you and to remember who and whose we are. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. Bless our confirmation students as they journey forward from this day. May they know that their good works and their words spoken are transformative, not only for them, but for those around them. We are grateful for the hope and the courage and the presence that they have provided us this day. Remind us to always turn to you in prayer, O God, and help us to pray the way Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
That the benediction found at the very end of a worship service is a special blessing spoken to us as we leave worship and go out into the world. Whether that blessing is short, go in peace, or long, the Lord bless you and keep you, ancient or composed in the moment, it brings a graceful conclusion to a sacred, heartfelt time and leaves us with a reminder that we are to go into God's world and the bearers of God's light and love.
Therefore, go forth blessed in knowing that you are created by a wise and wonderful God. Go forth seeking goodness, walking in mercy, and holding up all that is just and true. May you be the light, like a star in the night sky. May you bring glory and honor to God now and forevermore. Amen.